Our keynote today is Corey Mummery, the VP and GM of NFL Now with the National Football League. In his role, he's charged with leading the NFL Now product, which he'll talk about today, and which simultaneously launched across all major platforms in August of 2014. NFL Now packages all available NFL-produced live and on-demand video from NFL Films, NFL Network, NFL Games, and all 32 NFL teams into a cross-platform digital product. So I'm very excited to welcome Corey Mummery for our keynote this morning. Corey.
Great. Thank you very much. Thank you for having me here. This is my first time at Streaming Media West, so very happy to be here. So thank you for the introduction. I've been at the NFL for about 6 years now, working on many different products. I started working on fantasy football, most recently working on the NFL Now product. I'm going to focus my time here today to give a broad overview of what we're doing at the NFL within digital media specifically, and then focus quite a bit of time on NFL Now, what we built, how we built it, how we pulled all the content together and built on all the different platforms. And then if everything works out correctly, we'll do a bit of a demo on a couple of platforms at the end. So first off, NFL digital holistically. In roughly 2005, 2006, started working on NFL.com, bringing the operations of the site in-house. Spun up our facility in Culver City. At this time, NFL Network had launched already, was on air, and we were starting digital. So we were expanding our Culver City team, built in video streaming as part of this, but also just all the core components of what it takes to build the NFL site. So stats, player information, obviously building out editorial content, video production facilities. So that was our first step. Next step was to bring in one platform to service all 32 clubs, NFL clubs. So that included publishing, as well as working with all 32 clubs at their own facilities who were doing their own content creation, building a platform for them to publish that content and get it to their users, their fans. This is when I joined the NFL. My initial role was to scope, build requirements, build the team, and build fantasy football for the league. Prior to joining the NFL, I was at ESPN. Working on fantasy there from 2005 to 2008. Fantasy at the time was what our executive team defined as the third leg of the stool that we wanted to build for digital, obviously NFL.com and the club sites being the first two. So we launched fantasy football in 2010, got the site up. Those of you that play fantasy or maybe work on fantasy understand the complexities around building a fantasy platform. So very excited at the time to launch the platform. Today, it's one of the top three fantasy platforms. I'm sure if you play, you know the others, Yahoo, ESPN, many of our partners in the space. Fantasy is big, and it was great at the time to get the fantasy platform launched. Over the years, we've built other media products. We've partnered with Verizon over many years on NFL Mobile, and we've expanded that over the years, and we'll talk about NFL Now as the next step in mobile, as among other platforms as well. Another partnership is Microsoft, which is more recent over the last couple of years, putting the NFL application on connected devices, specifically Xbox devices, 360 and One. So this, if you haven't seen this application, actually, I recommend you check it out, download it to your console. It is really exciting to see all of the content come together in a gaming console, specifically the video content. And this was our first step into really seeing how users interacted with that type of content, specifically long-form video content on gaming consoles. And I will also say that this is one of the reasons when we started working on this product that NFL Now, it wasn't called that at the time, started to come into focus. We had a huge opportunity. We had the content, we had passionate users, the devices were starting to proliferate, and we could get a lot of consumption, and our users were demanding the content on these platforms. So the first step was Microsoft getting on the Xbox consoles, and we'll see what other consoles we're on now. Subscription products has always been a big part of our business. These are our logos, Game Pass, Game Rewind, Preseason Live, and Audio Pass. And they represent video content that is paid to access. So Game Pass, for example, is kind of your Sunday ticket type product for our international users, digital focused. And then today, our focus over the last year and a half or so, from a digital perspective, has been NFL Now. So this is where I'll focus the majority of my time today. I'm going to start with our kickoff that we had up in Seattle with the kickoff game beginning of September. Our video production team put together a video that I'll play now.
Starting back in the 60s, we were partnering with broadcast television. As things evolved and cable television came along,
the Buffalo Bills select Willis McGahee.
We created a partnership with ESPN. As satellite television came on in the 90s, we created a partnership with DirecTV and created Sunday Ticket. Those innovations have helped launch even a new series of innovations over the last 12 years. We have NFL.com. We created our own NFL network. We created the NFL Red Zone. And today, we're here to talk about NFL Now, which I believe is going to be the next generation of great innovations in the NFL's history.
It's time to experience NFL Now and the personalized nature of this digital library of NFL video like nothing we have ever seen before. I hope you will join me in welcoming NFL Hall of Famers Deion Sanders and Steve Largent. The first step in personalizing your NFL Now experience is to choose your favorite team or teams. Atlanta, San Francisco, Dallas, Washington, and Baltimore. The next step here is to pick your favorite player.
Well, I am a huge fan of Russell Wilson. Larry Fitzgerald is one of my favorite receivers, and it was long before he was a Bronco, and that's Peyton Manning.
We want to turn back to Deion's NFL Now experience and see how personalized the content gets.
Come on, ready?
Let's go.
Perfect execution. Five down.
What is that?
So right away, this is a great video from Cowboys training camp. As we know, one of Deion's favorite teams that he listed before, one of the teams he played for. This video was shot by the Cowboys when they attached a camera to Tony Romo's helmet. If Deion wants, he can sit back and he can watch this video and all the other videos in the stream that follow behind it. Or he can do it as we've done here, lean forward and pause this video as well and have some control over what he watches next. Again, this is video personalized based on the information that Deion gave us earlier on when he picked his favorite teams. Now we're going to turn to Steve Largent and take a look at how his NFL Now experience might look. As we can see right off the top, a different NFL Now experience for Steve than we saw with Deion, with the like, dislike features as well. It continuously customizes that NFL Now experience to each user. And this is something that every user gets for free with NFL Now. There is a premium version of NFL Now, and that's called NFL Now Plus. Instant in-game highlights from every game. Additionally, you've got a customized highlight stream of a user's favorite teams, favorite players, or even their fantasy players if they're playing on NFLnow.com. I get my scores, I get my highlights, I get my fantasy all in one place. Another added feature that users get as well are access to Now's extensive vault of NFL films, shows, and documentaries.
It's all about creating a unique experience for you, the fans. There's never been a deeper opportunity for you to get in to our content, to our video, the way you want to do it, when you want to do it, and on whatever platform you want.
So I think that lays out what we're doing with NFL Now, the vision, the step of the evolution of NFL digital, talking about why digital consumption, digital video consumption specifically, is so important now. In a lot of ways, the NFL was catching up a little bit, as kind of the commissioner laid out our TV contracts. That's number one priority because, for the most part, our users, our fans, want to watch the games on TV, and we know that, and we don't want to get in the way of that. We want to add increased distribution, increased touch points for users to consume the content. And we've all seen these stats. Users are using mobile more often for video, cord cutting, all the rest. This isn't a surprise to anyone here, but this is the reason NFL Now for us was so important. We had the content, we had the fans, we had the demand. We had to pull that together into a cross-platform application. in very simplistic terms, as we talk about the major video products that are in the marketplace that users use, you match that up to NFL content, the passion of NFL fans, and you get NFL Now. We'll also talk a little bit about personalization that we built into the Now product, which was important given the amount of content that we had, asking your user to find that content themselves in most cases is not really feasible. We're publishing hundreds and in many times thousands of pieces of video a day. On Sundays, we cut about 700 highlights throughout the course of the game, all the games on Sunday. So asking a user to find those highlights themselves is, you know, based on their preferences, favorite teams, fantasy comes into play, isn't really feasible. So we built a personalization engine that I'll talk a little bit about. It's important to note here, it's unauthenticated. We have a watch NFL and Red Zone application, like most media companies. Those applications exist. They're across platform, tablet, all the rest are actually hooked into the Microsoft Xbox application as well. That's not what this is. This is unauthenticated, over-the-top content aggregated all around the NFL. Let's talk a little bit about the content that we pull together. We have our 32 clubs, as I mentioned earlier. The clubs have the platform. They produce content, both written and video. So we pull together all of the video content that they produce in their facility into Now through, and this is one of the bigger technical challenges that we had. They have a publishing console that they use. There's different levels of expertise on the clubs in terms of video production. How they enter the metadata can be different across clubs. We had to normalize that. As I mentioned, personalization is a big piece of it. In order to build personalization efficiently, we had to normalize that data, which required some changes on the club side, but for the most part, we adjusted within the NFL Now platform to accommodate what the clubs were doing. Another thing to note here is that this is compelling content that users really were excited to see. And in some cases, they're going to seek it out. They're going to go to the club's site, chargers.com or whatever, and find this content. But in a lot of cases, they don't know that it exists. And it is important content for users because it provides a unique insight into the clubs. You saw the Tony Romo video there, for example. That's content that the club is going to produce, not NFL media. And so getting that type of content and matching it up to highlights and NFL media produced content is extremely powerful, especially when we put it into a single playlist, like we'll see here in a minute. So the clubs was the first piece of the puzzle here in terms of content. We obviously have films, which has been part of the NFL for many years and produces awesome content from Hard Knocks to Football Life and many other awesome titles that I'm sure a lot of people in this room have heard of. More long-form content, where clubs and NFL media is more short-form. NFL Films is more long-form. So that was a unique challenge because the content goes back many, many years. A lot of it isn't even digitized. So we had to go through a process of digitizing the content, figuring out the best way to do that with extremely old footage to make it look good, obviously within digital products, but also do it in a way where we can build businesses around it, whether it's insertion of ads or streaming it to the user in across all the different platforms from Apple TV all the way to mobile. So NFL Films was a big piece of what we were doing in terms of, I guess, content preparation or getting the content ready for the application. And this is ongoing. Films produces content every day, new shows, and we're also digitizing more of the older content that they've produced into the application. So we started off with about 1,300 different titles when we launched, and that continues to grow at a few hundred a month since launch. Highlights, it's a big piece of everything we do at NFL Media, not just in NFL Now, but we put highlights into fantasy football, NFL.com, club sites have highlights. Our users obviously want to watch the highlights of the games, and it's a unique piece of content that we can pull together fairly easily given our rights and what we can do with the content. The process by which we produce the highlights isn't all that easy because we have a couple of demands that we want to meet. Number one, we want to do all the highlights in real time while the games are going on. So there are many games going on at once, so we have multiple teams working together to cut the highlights. And number two, speed. We want to get the highlights to the site, not just NFL Now, but all of our platforms, as quickly as we possibly can. Our goal is within 1 minute. The play happens on the field. 1 minute later, the user can watch it in our digital products. It takes some unique partnerships, some unique kind of configurations that we put together, both in manpower and technology, to make that possible. But this is something that we've been refining over the last three or so years, and we're able to leverage a lot of that for NFL Now, and then we built some new processes in place because new technologies have become available to make it even better since the launch of NFL Now. So this is an example where all NFL digital products are benefiting from the investment that we made in NFL Now this year. Live is a big piece of what we do, not just in Now, but across the digital products. One thing, though, with Now is we wanted to aggregate all of our live content, all from the clubs as well. They do a lot of press conferences, interviews, things like that, as well as from NFL Media, where we do a lot of in-studio shows. Fantasy Live is a good example of that. The Rich Eisen Show, which just launched on DirecTV Audience Network, as well as NFL Now, is actually streaming now. Hopefully you can see an example of that when we get to the demo. Just a few examples of the live content that we're pulling into the platform. Obviously, we have NFL Network, NFL.com, what I've been referring to as NFL Media. We produce a lot of original content from our facilities in Culver City here, pulling that all into NFL Now as well. This one was a little bit easier from a metadata standpoint and normalization because we control all the metadata. We're publishing all of that content ourselves with our own video operations team. So this one was a little bit easier to pull together. And then we built a new studio dedicated to NFL Now. It's a virtual studio, green screen and the rest, couple of control centers connected to that. So we built out a whole new facility, and Iztok, who is on the stage with the commissioner there and running the kickoff event, he was our main talent, who's our host for this content. So we produce, I think it's 14 hours of original content a day, cut up. So they're taping for 14 hours. The end result is less than that, obviously. But we're continually producing content, and it's in real time, following storylines. I'm sure there's a lot of content being produced about Adrian Peterson this morning that we'll see here, for example. Jumping in and cutting a lot of short-form content that plays into personalization. So if there are storylines about players, or if we see a gap in content around whether it's a player or a team, whatever it may be, we have the team jump in, cut some content, make sure users who have those players in their personalized feeds are getting real-time content. So this is, in one case, this is kind of the filler to make sure that we're covering all storylines appropriately. But in the other case, it is a lot of times actually kind of breaking news, being ahead, and actually working with the clubs as well, saying, hey, we're going to cut this content on Peterson. Do you guys want to also follow suit? And as it all comes together, it kind of builds a storyline into the application. So this is the individual served content stream. We'll also see some curated channels that this content lives within as well. So holistically, this is the NFL Now content, as well as the Plus content, which is mainly the films, and as you heard on the piece, the highlights experience as well is part of the premium package. Personalization. So this piece, the goal of personalization for us was if we had thousands of individual video clips with metadata around, you know, player information, metadata around descriptions, teams, the type of content, is it talking about fantasy, is it news, whatever the case may be. So we have all of our video content broken down with all the metadata, and then on the other side, we have a wealth of user information as well, mainly around if they play fantasy, we know who their fantasy players are, we know who their favorite teams are. You know, interesting, not all users only have one favorite team. They choose multiple, which is something that we see in our data. And then number three, we can learn from a user's consumption. So a lot of times a user will say, I'm a favorite team, I'm a fan of this team, and then we watch them consume different types of content, whether it's, you know, locker room speeches. Fans love locker room speeches, so they'll watch locker room speeches for all teams, whether it's their favorite team or not. And so if we can learn from that and refine their personalized stream, make it more of a sit-back, linear way to consume NFL Now and video content for the NFL in general, that was the goal with personalization. There are many companies working on personalization. But for us, that's what we were trying to achieve. Not necessarily recommending content or long form content or you watch this so you may like this. It was more about building a linear stream of content, NFL content specifically. Quickly walk through the platform that we built. I've talked about a few of these already. I mentioned personalization is a standalone application that we built as part of our middleware application, which basically pulled in all that information and distilled it down into a single API request. I have this user, give me some video, and we just, the personalization engine, a lot going on in the back end, obviously, but basically just returns a list of unique video IDs that the application can then build the playlist off of. Obviously, we have the registration and fantasy football. I've mentioned that. Users are signing in to existing platforms within the NFL that we've built over the years, whether it's fantasy or a registration system, pulling enough of that into NFL Now to know who the user is and matching that up to personalization. And then the video platform, which that's what we focused the majority of our time in rebuilding for this year for NFL Now, to stream video at high enough bit rate for Apple TV, which for the NFL was new, as well as do it at a scale. We were expecting millions of users. We have millions of users on the platform. So we were, had to stream at that level. And then parsing of the metadata and making the metadata available to the clients when they were building the application is also a key piece of the video processing and publishing. And then on top of that, we built the client applications. So obviously, you know, we're on desktop on the left side here. The mobile applications, we're on all major mobile applications. We have distributions as kind of like channels within Yahoo Screen specifically. You'll see NFL and NFL Now channel on Yahoo Screen. And then NFL Mobile, I mentioned earlier, that's our Verizon partnership. That also has an NFL Now channel. So different touch points, try and get to the user where the user already is. That includes Xbox, which I mentioned earlier. This is the partnership with Microsoft, so you see an NFL channel on Xbox. Again, the users are there. Getting the users to adopt a new platform, in a lot of cases, makes sense. In mobile, download a dedicated mobile app, which we'll see here in a second. Apple TV, it makes a lot of sense as well, but there are platforms that we're already on, and putting a channel on those platforms was the better approach because the users are there. It's already video-focused, so let's just integrate NFL Now into those platforms. So all in all, you know, NFL Now, pulling it all together, distributing to these platforms. So this is what we did. This is what we built. So let's take a look at the commercial here where we kind of kicked it off, and then I'll talk a little bit about how we did.
Now listen up, NFL. I want my NFL the way I want it, and I want it now.
I want my team.
I want my own stream.
I want the highlights and breaking news my way.
Cause fantasy I play.
Now I want Chiefs highlights, Chiefs player interviews, the Chiefs 1970 Super Bowl, and maybe some up-to-the-minute news on my second favorite team, the Chiefs.
Play fast sacks. I want it now.
NFL Now, the biggest NFL video library on the planet, available on every device and personalized just for you. Sign up today at NFL.com/now.
So if you watched any football games this fall, you probably saw that commercial. We've been airing it quite a bit. That's one of the great things about being part of the NFL family is we certainly have the inventory to broadcast big messages like this, get the whole league behind an initiative, which is true in the case of NFL Now. So let's talk a little bit about performance and how we've done to date. So we launched beginning of August, right before preseason. We've had many iterations and subsequent launches on different platforms throughout the month, at least the first 2 weeks of August. By the end of August, so the end of the preseason, we were fully distributed up on and ready for the start of the season. So basically what we saw from a high level, mobile, desktop and tablet making up a majority of consumption on Sunday. This is mostly mobile, and it makes a lot of sense. I don't think it's a big shock. Where users are checking in from time to time. We see this in fantasy and other NFL products as well. Checking in from time to time. They're probably away from the house or their computer, and they want to check in highlights. This is, I think, one of the beauties of personalization in NFL Now. You launch it, you see video that pertains to you. In the case of the Sunday experience, you're going to see a lot of highlights in your feed, specifically for your fantasy players or your favorite team. So you check in, see those big plays, and then jump out. And so kind of jumping in and jumping out means lower duration, but lots of visits. Again, not a surprise. And then non-game days, we see most of the consumption on connected, and it's fairly dramatic. I'll show some stats here in a second. So users watching not just long-form content around films, but also more consumption of their personalized feed. In the order of 10 to 15, depending on the user, video clips that they're just sitting back and watching on non-game days. The demand for NFL content and specifically video content is there. We've proven that out with not just NFL Now, but the other products. And it's coming true again with NFL Now, giving the products to the user on the platforms that they want it. They're coming to consume at a pretty high rate. And some of these platforms are new to the NFL. Like I mentioned earlier, Apple TV. We didn't know a lot about the consumption on that platform. Roku would be another one. Until we got this launched and got the users engaged with the product. And so those platforms specifically have been a nice surprise for us in terms of duration, content consumed, and the type of content that the user is watching, more premium content, longer form content on those connected devices, which, you know, not a big surprise, but we're already planning for next year to take advantage of some of those consumption metrics that we're seeing this year. So as far as stats go, for visits, users coming and watching a single video, that's basically how we've been defining a visit, majority of the visits on mobile, again, kind of proving it out, about half of our visits, shorter visits, obviously, as you'll see in the other stats here, but connected devices at 19%, we were surprised by that. That was higher than we thought. We thought tablet would be higher. Desktop is about where we thought it would be, about a quarter of the traffic in terms, again, of visits. We'll see the other stats here in a second. So mobile was a surprise. That was a little higher than we thought, but connected devices definitely a lot higher than we thought it would be. In terms of video begins, it starts to skew a little bit to connected devices. Again, we were surprised by tablet. I'd be interested to hear what others are seeing in tablet, but we have a very similar experience on tablet as we have on desktop and mobile, similar content, just less consumption than we assumed on tablet. But again, connected devices starting to pick up. And then the last one was the biggest surprise for us in terms of connected devices. So I have an Xbox down there, but that represents all connected devices, Apple TV and Roku. And so you see mobile where the minutes are low, but 20% of our minutes on mobile devices, that's not too bad. That's higher than we thought. But really the connected devices being over half of our minutes consumed, that's a pretty big number. And again, like I mentioned earlier, something that we're focused on for 2015, we think we have a big opportunity here. Some of this is, we feel, devices we're already on and have been for the last couple of years, so users are used to seeing us on the Xboxes, for example. But there's devices that were brand new We were never on Apple TV before this year, or Roku. So users had, especially in the case of Roku, had to find the application, download it, and get engaged with the application, which is asking a lot. You know, it happens over time, but for it to happen in the first year was a pleasant surprise for us. So if this works out, I'm going to try and do a demo. 1 second. Alrighty. And then I'll pause after this and get some questions. All right. That is not good. All right. So I'm in the application. I've mentioned I'm signed in this case. We got this set up earlier. So I'm signed in. I should mention I'm a Chargers fan. So you see some Chargers content here. I also play fantasy football, so we'll see some of my fantasy players either here or on the phone. Something that we do in the new studio that we built in Culver City is to build content that tries to set the stage as well. I should have mentioned this earlier. We produce a need to know segment. I think it's three or four that we produce a day now to try and set the stage before the user gets into their personalized feed of everything that's going on at the NFL. If you've seen the news this morning, Peterson is in the news. So that's his thumbnail there, and I'm sure they talk about fantasy football quite a bit in the need to know. And then this is my personalized feed. So will the Chargers make the playoffs? I don't know. I hope so. Their report card here, B-, has been decreasing, according to our guys. It was A earlier in the season. Luckily, we got the win this week. So all about the Chargers here. And some highlights as well. I should also mention that as you watch content in your personalized feed, it goes away. And it goes into a history section. We did that on purpose, so it's a personalized live stream, again, that you can come back often and see the content that you haven't watched yet. So this is a personalized stream of content. If I go back up to the top and go into series here, we can see a lot of the other curated content that we pull together. So most popular is content that is curated, kind of the most viewed content on the platform as our editorial and video production team is looking at the real-time stats. So this is just kind of high-level, everything that's going on, high-level curated content. And then as we get into the other, we build many, many channels for the content. I'm going to scroll down a little bit, get into some of the premium content. You see Hard Knocks and others in here. And so this is basically all of, in terms of the content that we produce, everything within NFL Now, and we'll see the live content. I mentioned the Rich Eisen show earlier. So the Rich Eisen is streaming live here. So let's see what they're, hopefully this works, what they're talking about now.
Feel it?
JJ Watt.
You know the game's on tonight, right?
Well, I know, but it's my turn to chaperone.
NFL Mobile is now free with the More Everything plan from Verizon. Download it, and you can watch the game right here.
Hey, JJ.
What's up, girl?
Get NFL Mobile included with the More Everything plan.
Whenever there's a house that gets sold in my neighborhood for an absurd amount of money, more than whatever I would absolutely think it's worth, I'm like, way to go. You sell for that much. Do you feel the same way when you see Giancarlo's contract, Mike?
You know, I'm just happy. I'm happy for him. Mm-hmm. You know, he's...
All right. No idea where that's going. But So Rich Eisen streaming live, personalized content. Now I'm going to switch over to the phone. Okay, so I am logged in with the same account. 1 second here. That is not what I want to see. All right. Very similar to what we saw on Apple TV, except for in this case, my personalized stream is up at the top. The video player is portrait with Maox Slant. That's a video player, so just not playing video right now. But this is my personalized stream. And then these, very similar to what we saw on Apple TV, are all the channels that are available. And it's the same content across platform. That's one of the things that it wanted to show here, that it's the exact same content. I can stop on mobile here, move over to Apple TV, and watch similar content. One thing that is unique on mobile that is a little bit harder to build on Apple TV is the highlights experience. So we've broken down highlights. These are my fantasy teams here at the top. By the book, so I had some good matchups, some bad. And we broke it down by fantasy. Favorite players, which is my players, all my highlights related to my players, and then all of the NFL matchups as well. So as I click in, I can see the NFL matchups. This is a unique experience on game day specifically. Obviously, sitting here on a Tuesday when there aren't any games going on, all the content is produced and it's aggregated. But on game day or Monday Night Football, Thursday Night Football, you would see live content coming into this as it was produced. Again, going back to the minute or so after the play happens on the field, we're trying to get it into the application. That's our goal. Live, I'm not going to watch anymore, but Rich Eisen is there, same content. And then all my personalized feed up at the top, as well as the history of all the content that I've watched recently. So just a quick demo of what we've done with NFL Now across platform. I mentioned the others earlier, tablet and the rest. You'll see the NFL Now application there as well. So with that, I'll take any questions that you have.
Jose and I will come around with a microphone if you have questions. I see some over there. Jose's got you.
All right. You mentioned, and it was pretty interesting to, I think, a lot of us, that the you got such saturation on the connected devices. Did you do any kind of marketing or outreach to tip that? I mean, what kind of things did you do to let people know that the channels were available on Roku and Apple devices and whatnot? So,
yeah, absolutely. The quick answer is yes. So on Microsoft, given the unique relationship we have with them, they're doing a lot of marketing. You may have seen the fantasy-related commercials with the NFL application specifically on the Microsoft platforms. So we benefited from all the work that Microsoft was doing. All of the NFL did, as well as Microsoft, obviously. But NFL Now, again, being a channel within that platform, benefited from that marketing campaign. The other platforms, it's not... Marketing for connected devices, we found, was a little challenging. Working directly with, for example, Roku. So, you know, they have institutional inventory within Roku, whether it's banners or promotions on the platform. We took advantage of all those things. Apple TV is a little bit harder in some ways. They don't have that type of inventory on the platform, but it's easier in others that all users just get the application as soon as you publish it. And so what we did was we leveraged what was available on each of those platforms to make users aware of it. But it becomes a challenge because off those platforms, because you're talking to a broad, you know, set of users, many of which probably don't have a connected TV device. And so you need to really be selective on how you market, you know, especially using, for example, TV inventory or something like that, banner ads, things like that, to talk to those users, because they may not even have the platform and may not be able to get access to it. So we use digital assets off platform, email campaigns, and things like that. But yeah, we did what we could to target the users that we knew had the platform and then make them aware of the new product.
We have another question here, and then we'll come over there.
Hi, this is Joel Esplin from the Diffusion Group. Could you speak a little bit to, is there a plan or a mandate for monetization around NFL Now, or is it sort of purely as a marketing and engagement vehicle?
Yeah, so kind of a two-pronged approach right now. And to be honest, we were more testing to than anything, you know, not really looking to drive tremendous revenue this year. But we built a transactional product mainly around the long-form films content. So very cheap price point of $1.99 a month to get you access to all of the paid long-form content. We put the highlights experience in there as well. And then international, we have unique opportunity around content. So you can get Red Zone over the top, NFL Network over the top, and then we distributed a live free game of the week to our international users. So just, again, trying to test the platform, see what works, see test engagement, see what users are willing to consume on the digital platform. A lot of those were successful, and we'll do more of it. Some of them, not so much. You saw the McDonald's, actually that was a Verizon ad with JJ Watt. So we have advertisement in the platform as well as a second pillar of monetization. That's always a balance. We want it to be integrated with the content in a way that doesn't take away from the user experience, but obviously we want to drive value for our sponsors. So again, kind of testing the timing of those ads, when the user loads the application, when does it play? Does it play when they choose the first video? Does it play after the first video? We were just messing around and testing some of those things, engaging response from users around consumption of the content, duration of visits, things like that, to try and find the right point where advertisement works and it doesn't drive users away and leads to more consumption. So this year was a lot of testing, and we're in the process of refining what we're doing, and we're putting a plan together for next year and probably do some different things.
I have two questions. One, you have a lot of metadata, as you've demonstrated there. I'm just curious how much is now been virtualized or automated versus how much is actually doing manual resource, human resources. And the second question is, how much statistics have you done on the actual bandwidth usage of the end users? Like, how adaptive is the streams having to be?
Yep. So on the first one, that comes in two parts. The actual production of the content. So someone actually creating a piece of content and putting it into the CMS. We try and highlights is probably the best example where speed matters, where we try and automate as much of that as possible. And for us, that means around highlights specifically, we have data feeds that are coming in from the stadiums. That are giving us all of the play information. And so if you associate a highlight to an individual play ID, first to a game and then to a play ID, then you get all the metadata that you need from that play. For example, the players that were in it, the teams that are playing, obviously, description, you get the play description. And so we built a platform that basically takes in that ID and pre-populates the rest of the metadata. One of the many things we did to speed up the production of highlights. The production of other content that wasn't highlights, for right now, it's for a lot of it is manual, kind of playing off some other content that we have in the system. If they associate a video to an article, we can pull in some of that that content or a storyline or things like that. But for the most part, the video that we're producing is standing on its own, and so the video production team enters the content, and that's true at the clubs as well. True at films as well, but that's longer form content. They have a little bit more time. It's not as time sensitive to produce the content, so not as demanding there. And then your second question. Sorry. Adaptive bitrate. Yes, thanks. Obviously, we've set up the platform to be a little different across the platform. So mobile starts at a lower bitrate and works its way up. But we use HLS across all the platforms, including desktop, which initially was a bit of a challenge, but we're able to get that figured out. So we use HLS across all platforms. The starting bit rate is a little bit different per platform. Apple TV is a little bit higher than mobile, obviously. But for the most part, you know, when we look at CDN logs and things like that, the consumption that we're seeing is at the highest, for the most part anyway, I mean, it differs, but at the highest bit rate available, which for us is 5 megabit. That we offer, and that's another thing we're looking at for next year of offering higher bit rates as well.
Question in the back here.
Hi, Robert Reinhardt, Video RX. I just wanted to know more about your technology stack, if whatever you can talk about, from CDNs to hardware to what you've built in-house versus what you've bought. So, thank you.
Yeah, that's a big question. Could talk for quite a while on that. For the most part, the middleware is proprietary. We use a couple of different CMSs. Alfresco is one of them that we use. But for the most part, everything that we built on the middleware side is proprietary, including the personalization engine. We built that in-house. The processing of video content in terms of metadata and publishing that out to the CDN. For the most part, we use Akamai for CDN and video streaming. Dynamic packaging specifically, which we have a few NFL employees here in the room that they worked on getting that set up with Akamai. Client side was it depends on the platform, obviously. For the most part, we built all the applications in-house. There's some unique situations where we had league-level partnerships, like Microsoft, for example, where we didn't build it in-house, but worked in tandem with Microsoft. But for the most part, we built everything in-house.
Maybe time for one more question. Eric, right here.
I didn't see a hand. Can someone raise a hand?
4K, are you guys digitizing your NFL Films library in 4K? Are you producing anything in 4K for the library? And have you looked at distribution? Are you looking at smart TVs as a platform? Where are you on 4K in general?
Yep. Looking at 4K, aren't doing it yet, but looking at it. As far as distribution, we are continuing to look at new platforms. And for us, that really is where users are consuming content. Which is, the marketplace is changing almost on a daily basis with new platforms coming out. And so we want to be on platforms that users are using to simplify it as much as possible. There are big platforms that are already out there that we aren't on yet, and we're focused on those. Sony PlayStation is the biggest, so we're currently working on that. Others, like Android TV, are fairly new. We're looking at adoption, see how users are consuming on those platforms, and then make decisions on that. But for the most part, we're fully distributed outside of connected TV, and so we're happy there, but focused most of our energy in terms of distribution on connected TV.
Well, thank you very much, Corey.
Great. Thank you.